and good evening. I am Shelley Hauser, tonight your guest for the League of Women Voters show. In case you've never seen our show before, we are a group of nonpartisan men and women here in Berks County and throughout the United States who work on hot topics and political, in a nonpartisan way, political topics such as voting rights, disability voting rights, and this evening we're going to be talking about the code breakers for Women's History Month. So thanks for joining us. If you'd like to call in, our number is 610-378-0426. So this evening, I have two guests from the local area. My first guest here is Holly Vaughn. She's a woman's local historian and a former third and fourth grade teacher at which school district?
Muhlenberg.
Okay, well, welcome.
Thank you.
And Vicki Hefner is the education curator at the Berks Historical Center here in the city. And where is it located?
It's located at 940 Center Avenue, which is the intersection of Center and Spring Street.
So, very good. So, thank you so much, ladies, for being here with us. So, the code breakers. Unless you study World War II history and or lived through that time, you may not know what that was. And I actually, maybe in talking to Hallie, even if you lived during that time, you still may not have known who the code breakers really were.
True.
So can you please tell us who or what these code breakers were?
Okay, and I'd like to show you the book also. It's called The Code Girls, and they were from World War II. This is a book by Liza Monday, and she did a lot of research on the code girls from World War II. Who were they? Well, after Pearl Harbor happened, the United States discovered that their intelligence in overseas was very poor and very weak. And so they decided they needed some help with code breaking of the Japanese and the German codes that were being used during the war. The Navy sent out letters to the seven sister colleges in the Northeast. And these were Wellesley, Bryn Mawr, Mount Holyoke, Barnard, Smith, Radcliffe, and Vassar. They wanted the most prestigious schools and the smartest graduates to come and be their code breakers. When they sent their letters out, they asked the girls two questions. Do you like crossword puzzles, and are you engaged to be married? Almost at the same time, the Army also was looking for code breakers, and they decided that they were going to focus on the colleges that were training women to be teachers, and also teachers that might have wanted a new career. So the Army sent some of its officers to teaching schools throughout the country, and they asked them the same two questions.
Oh, okay.
And as a result, they began their identifying of these girls that would be working, breaking codes for the Army or the Navy.
So the Army and the Navy basically had different approaches as to how they fielded these questions out, these letters out.
Yes.
But basically the same questions were asked of these ladies.
They were looking for women who were good in languages because they needed people that could translate German. They needed women who could pick up languages easily. And like the one woman who was featured in the book, her name was Dot Braden, she said that learning languages, even Latin, for her was like sleeping.
Okay.
So she was very good at languages. Others looked for math teachers. There was a young gal from the Indiana University of Pennsylvania, who was a math student. She was the only woman in some of her calculus and other advanced math courses. And so she was looking to become a math teacher.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the Navy was looking for women who also were good at like engineering and physics and that kind of thing, and also the language.
So during these years, how common was it to have a broad cross-section of women going to college?
Well,
was it common?
No, it wasn't. And that was one of the reasons why the Seven Sisters started their programs, because the women were not accepted at like your Harvard and your Yale, some of those prestigious Northeastern colleges. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't real common for women to go to college back then.
Right. Yeah. And what years did all of this happen between?
Right after Pearl Harbor was when this concentrated effort went out. And even some time before that, in 1941, actually before Pearl Harbor, they knew that they were coming up short in the intelligence business. And so they had already sent some of these letters to the Seven Sister Schools even before Pearl Harbor. But after Pearl Harbor, then they went after these young women in earnest. Mm.
So you talked about the Army and the Navy, and this is something we didn't talk about before. The Army and the Navy decided that they were coming up short. But what about the Marines and the Air Force? You know, is there any mention in any of your history that you've done that mentions them as well?
Well, I don't think the Marines was even in the Marines until after World War II.
Oh, okay, so they didn't even happen.
I might be wrong about that. And the Air Force...
it's a little bit before our time,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah. Okay. It was basically just the Army and the Navy.
Okay, so they were the core ones that did it.
Yeah.
So now... these girls all went to college. Were any of them homemakers? You said some were teachers.
They did not. They figured married women were problematic. That's the way they put it.
Okay.
Problematic because when the men went off to war, oftentimes the women went, I mean, where they could. If they were stationed stateside, the women would go with them. They did not want women with children because they knew that these code breakers, when they got involved with it, they worked 12-hour shifts, and they had to really focus in on what they were doing. And so married women, they figured, were problematic. That's one of the reasons why the question was asked, are you engaged to be married? Because they figured if the woman was going right from college to be married, that would be it. She would just follow where her husband went. And usually at that time, I believe it's like 75 or 80% of teachers in America, when they got married, they had to quit teaching.
Wow, that's amazing.
So
times have really changed, haven't they?
So, yes.
So we're going to take a break. We do have a home caller, a home viewer calling in. So welcome and thanks for calling in. Who's this?
Oh, Larry.
Hi, Larry. What's your question?
Well, I just wanted to correct something that your historian said.
Yeah. Okay.
As well as you. The Marine Corps, you know, from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli.
Yes.
They date back to the late 1700s.
Oh, wow.
Formed in Philadelphia in the Toon Tavern. If other Marines were to listen to this tonight, you'll have many calls.
Oh.
And secondly, the Air Force was not formed until the late 40s. Okay. Prior to that, it was the Army Air Corps.
Right.
Became the Air Force in the late 40s.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I knew, you know, I thought after I said it I was wrong, because I knew the Air Force wasn't organized until after the in the 40s.
Yes, but the mortal sin was your comments about the Marines.
Yeah. So I apologize. Thank you for clarifying. It was before my
time. Yeah, just say you're sorry and move on.
No, but were you around during World War II?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so you did. Okay, so stay tuned and learn more about these code girls. And thank you so much for calling.
You're quite welcome.
Thank you. Okay, so now we all learned something. So the homemakers, and they were problematic. What happens, and in your research, did you ever find any of these young ladies that were going to college and being code breakers, did they ever fall in love and then get pregnant and go down that path and have to leave?
Well, some of them did, yes.
Okay.
Some of them did. In her book, she said that the Navy, when they in their code breaking unit, they were very strict and did. When someone got pregnant, they were
out.
They were out. The Army, Army's code breaking unit was much more lenient. They were kind of a mixed bag of people. Mm. There were all different age groups. There were men and women who were code breakers, and they did not wear uniforms as code breakers. Whereas the Navy unit, they were Navy waves, and they wore their uniforms.
I think the front cover of the book shows
they were stricter.
Shows that if we can cut away to that a little bit,
they were much stricter.
Yeah,
in the Navy group.
Mm-hmm. And the Army group could just wear whatever business work,
yes,
business,
yes,
that they had.
Yes.
Business casual or whatever,
right,
they cost you.
Yes.
So why did some men do this work but not all men?
Well, it was seen as a career breaker if you had desk duty and you weren't.
So that was not a good thing.
Right. The officers did not want the job for that reason.
Okay.
So they were looking for people who were willing to sit at a desk all day long and do very tedious,
manual
drudgery.
Yeah. So I think we have a picture of some of the people there. There we go, some of the workers that
those were the waves.
Yep. So, okay. And where did they work? Like, how was all this concealed? Did they work on the base?
Well, the Army had they took over a farm, which was called Arlington Farm, and it became Arlington Hall. And they built the dorms because these women were coming to the Washington, Arlington area by the hundreds.
Okay.
And they needed all these dormitories for them to live in.
Yeah.
So they were kind of thrown up on this former Arlington Farm area. Now, the Navy's unit was in Washington. When they outgrew their home, they took over a seminary, which was called the Mount Vernon Seminary, but then most people just called it the Annex.
Okay.
And I think they took that over sort of like by eminent domain.
Yeah.
When they needed a bigger place.
They just took it.
For them.
Now, are either one of these facilities still functioning and being used today?
I'm not sure. After the war, the Army and the Navy went together, and I believe they went to Maryland and located someplace in Maryland together.
Mm-hmm. Did these girls get, and guys, so they lived in these dorms. Did they get weekends off? Did they get time to go into the city and hang out?
Yes, and she goes into that in her book. They did, they had like dances they would go to. They got free bus passes to go around Washington. They got in free to museums and other, other places, museums and historical societies and They got in reduced rates to movies and plays and the opera. So they were given a lot of passes on things.
So this wasn't like a really long jury duty.
No, but they did. They did work. Some of them worked 12-hour shifts.
Right.
Some of them worked 3 8-hour shifts, and they were swing shifts. So they were between those. You know, they had to work a lot.
So how did the swing shift work? They worked like 9 to 5, and then took a break, and then came back.
Well, you were either on the morning or the afternoon or the graveyard
overnight
shift.
Yeah.
And then maybe after a week of that, you would go to one of the other shifts.
Oh, okay. Boy, that would mess up their sleeping schedules a little bit, I think, if you're not used to that. Yeah.
So. Exactly.
Very good. So how was all of this concealed?
Well, the women, especially like Dot Braden Bruce, when she was when she applied for this position, they didn't tell her much. They asked a lot of questions, like you would imagine, you know, your age and what's your family like. You had to be born in America. Mm-hmm. You couldn't be, you know, an immigrant and be in this. They asked about her brothers who were both in the Army. They asked, of course, for all her grades. And they said that she would be doing something called cryptography, but she didn't know what that was.
Yeah.
And they made it kind of secret. When they started into this, when she was accepted into this, she was sent to Washington. She said she was on the train. Somebody asked her what she was going to be doing. She said she had no idea exactly what she was going to be doing. Yeah. They called it cryptanalysis, but nobody had said much. When they got there, they started orientation, and the next thing she knew, she was going to be breaking codes and sinking ships.
Did any of these new employees, during or after that training, is it mentioned in the books whether or not they backed out and said, I don't want to be a part of this?
Yes, some of them did. And you asked about how they kept the secret. They were told that under no circumstances were they now or in the future or ever to talk about their job or what they were doing with anyone, not family,
right,
not roommates, not friends, not anyone, or they could be arrested under the Espionage Act. And they told the girls, don't think that because you're a woman that you won't be shot.
So they scared them.
Yeah. And then when they got, I mean, these offices that they worked in, they had to be careful what they put in the wastebaskets. Mm-hmm. There were armed security around them. Dot Braden said there was wire all around the building. I imagine it was barbed wire. And it was strict security.
That sounds really scary. And like, not really a great, you know, hey, let's go out and get coffee and pie after dinner kind of environment. I would think that's a little much.
Exactly.
That's intense. So they went through background checks and clearances for the employees, but did the families and spouses and parents and brothers and sisters also have to go through the background checks and clearances?
They probably...
You assume so, yeah.
Yeah.
I would assume so. Yeah.
And they were told that if they were asked what they were going to be doing, like when Dot said, well, I'm going to Washington to work for the government, what are you going to be doing? She was told that they were to say they were working communications. And if asked what they were doing, oh, I'm sharpening pencils, I'm answering phones, you know, it was no details as to what they were would be doing.
And in looking back at how amazing, you know, women are and have been in our history, and in celebrating Women's History Month, it just kind of really shocks me that they went to these Seven Sister colleges, these prestigious colleges, mm-hmm. at a time where women didn't really go to college, and or they were expected to go and they'd get married and be a homemaker, mm-hmm. kind of thing. But that their education and their intelligence and their creativity was not really utilized to the fullest extent. And then when it was for this kind of job, they weren't allowed to celebrate it.
Right.
You know, they were just supposed to keep it hush-hush and say, oh, I was sharpening pencils and schlepping coffee all day. Mm-hmm. So how do you put that on a resume and be prestigious? You don't really get very far in life when you do that.
Right.
So that's the downside of this. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad these stories came out and that these women have been able to share, because it just, I think, pushes our generation and future generations of women further to have their voice and celebrate all of their accomplishments, really.
And they knew that almost everyone that they were acquainted with was involved in the war. Their brothers, their dads, their uncles, and that they knew that the job that they were doing was very important. Mm-hmm. If they broke the codes, people lived. If they didn't break the codes, they didn't live.
Yeah. So this they took to heart.
And they took it very seriously. Many of them years later said it was a time in their life that they felt of the most useful.
Patriotic. Yeah.
And exciting, because there was constant motion, there was constant activity, there was constant work. The codes changed all the times. The Japanese changed their codes frequently because of people breaking their codes.
Yeah.
And so these women had to do their best every shift they went to.
Yeah. So I guess every little piece of a code or a full code that was broken and translated was like a little victory.
Exactly.
So did they ever fully get the hang of it by the end of all of this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they did.
So, can we see the inside of the book that shows the inside flap of the book that shows how really crazy, and maybe you can explain and make heads and tails of some of this.
Each of these numbers or letters, whatever they were, stood for a code group. And that code group might be a word or it might be a phrase.
Right. There were some words on there, isn't there?
Right, there are some words on there. And these were just terribly, you had to look at them and decide what pattern you saw with them, what was alike about them. And it, like I said, it could have stood for one letter or a phrase. And then they had to find out what was alike about them.
Right.
And then there were also things called additives that they put on, and they had to encrypt, they had to decrypt, they had to take the additives off these codes and figure out what they meant. It was very tedious, very boring sometimes, mm-hmm. except when it wasn't boring, you know.
It was exciting.
It was exciting. Yeah. That was what they did.
Yeah. And I think we have a photograph somewhere, of that code. And then there were computers that were created at this time as well to...
Right, they were bomba machines. They did the same thing as the people did, but they were faster, and people made more mistakes than the machines made.
Right.
So these machines became very helpful also. And you have a picture up there of...
Now, did these machines just run 24/7? Do you know?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Do they need the girls or the staff to man them?
Yeah, you had to put like
spool?
A disc or something, a scroll in there, and then it tried to also like see the patterns or see what was the same about these different codes. And then they had like big books, like a dictionary almost, that they would put these different codes in. So 2 weeks down the road, if they found a code that looked vaguely familiar, they'd go to this book mm-hmm. and look it up and see if it matched anything that they were looking at.
Just that would save them some time.
Exactly. So,
who developed all this code breaking?
Well, it was even before World War II, code breaking was popular with certain groups of people, but it was sometimes looked at back then as kind of like a hobby. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't taken very seriously at first, but There was William Friedman and his wife, Elizabeth Smith Friedman, mm-hmm. and there was an Agnes Meyer Driscoll that worked on these codes for years and years. And she was, if you wanted somebody to break your code for you, you went to Agnes Meyer Driscoll.
So we have a picture of her there in our book as well.
And so...
What was her background that she was so good at this?
She just was a kind of a scholar, and she liked doing this kind of thing.
Her brain just worked that way.
Yes. Yeah. And because of her, the code breakers of World War II had a little bit more background to go to.
A base to start
off
with.
Yes. Okay. Because she worked for years and years on these codes.
Now, had she married? Do you know?
Yes, she was married, okay. Yes.
And yet she was still able to do this work?
Yes.
Wow. So that was a real rarity right there.
Right.
Interesting.
And Elizabeth Friedman also.
She
was Elizabeth Smith. And she and her husband actually met doing code-breaking work.
Yeah.
And then the two of them... everybody always thought William was the brains behind the two, but they said she was every bit as good as he was at breaking the codes.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. So what were the codes for and who used them? The Japanese and the Russians?
The Japanese and the Germans during World War II used them.
Okay.
Because the Japanese didn't want the Americans to know where their ships were going. Mm-hmm. They didn't want any of that known, so they would write their logs and their journals, their schedules in these codes.
And how were these codes transferred within Japan or within Germany? Morse code, or how were they sent?
I think
sent?
They were sent by cable or by wire.
Okay.
And then... Of course, the Japanese and the Japanese, they knew what the codes were for their groups. But then the United States would kind of intercept. They had these intercepting stations.
In America or in their country?
Well, it would have been in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
It was in America. And they would have these intercept stations, and then they would intercept. And then they would try to figure out what these codes really meant.
That's interesting. So, the Army and the Navy, were they breaking the same codes? Were they doing the same exact projects?
No. The Army code girls and the Navy code girls didn't have much association with each other, but their commanders did, and so they kind of divvied up the work.
Mm-hmm.
So the Navy was doing X and the Army was doing Y. And
so the top officials of the Army and the Navy were basically talking to each other.
Right.
But everybody below them was not.
Yes. And they were in kind of like competition with each other.
Yeah.
You know, the Army code girls wanted to get their codes broken before the Navy could do theirs. And, you know, it was a bit of a competition until after the war when they both came back together.
Well, I think I've seen a few football games between the Army and the Navy that
<Right. laughs> Yeah.
They still are kind of competitive a little bit.
Exactly.
So, yeah. So you said how many men or women were doing this kind of work?
10,000 women were involved with this by the end of the war.
Okay. On both sides?
Well, I think it was like 4,000 in the Navy and 6,000 in the Arlington Hall unit.
Yeah. And just out of curiosity, on a side note, when they got their paychecks or they were logged as to what their job rank was, how was that all concealed? I mean, did their friends and family know that they worked on the base for the Army or the Navy, or was that even itself covered up and concealed?
I believe the families of the women knew where they were. But, I mean, as far as what they were doing, they didn't tell their families.
Anything. Yeah.
Anything.
So, had you found, we had talked about maybe finding a little paragraph that was of real serious interest in the book. Did you find a little passage that...
I found... Yes, I did.
So read that for us.
All right, and this was... this was in 1944 in June, so it was close to the end. Code breaking of many kinds helped cement the Allied decision in November of 1943. The Purple Machine, and the Purple Machine was a code. At Arlington Hall, rattled out one of the most valuable contributions that Hiroshi Oshima, the Japanese ambassador to Nazi Germany, made to the American intelligence effort. It was a wordy, effusive, somewhat emotional, meticulous description of German fortifications along the northwestern coast of France from Brittany to Belgium. Actually, it was a series of messages. The first was a missive in which Oshima bragged to colleagues in Tokyo about a trip he had taken to see Nazi operations in France. He and some colleagues had traveled by train from Berlin to Brest to inspect defenses there and along the French coast, what the Germans called the Atlantic Wall. Oshima, who admired the Nazis, was full of details about who in the army was who. He described being feted by Marshal Rundstedt and what an honor it had been to meet them. He reported that he and his companions had observed German defenses around Lorient, the Brittany seaport. They had seen night maneuvers, inspected encampments and harbors, spent the night in Paris, and gone on to Bordeaux, where they watched blockade runners carry out maneuvers. They headed to Poitiers and Nantes, meeting with German commanders. When we were wined and dined, we got the chance to talk with the right people everywhere. But he goes on to say, let's see. Oshima provided the kind of granular on-the-ground intelligence the Allies needed to defeat them. He noted that the Straits area is given first place in the German Army's fortification scheme and troop dispositions. By this, he meant the Strait of Dover, which is the narrowest part of the English Channel, the point where the crossing is shortest, connecting Dover in England to Calais, the French port. Normandy and the Brittany Peninsula come next in importance, his message continued. The other parts are regarded as only secondary fronts. He then detailed where German troops were located, explaining that the army occupying the Netherlands stretched to the mouth of the Rhine. Another army extended from there to west of Le Havre, and so forth. He provided a tally of divisions, infantry, armored, mechanized, airborne, and their strengths and number. All this was run through the embassy's machine in Berlin, transmitted to Tokyo, plucked out of the air by the WACS working at the Vint Hill Intercept Facility, deciphered by the Purple Unit at Arlington Hall, and rendered into English by linguists in the translating division. If the code girls had they had tied it up with a ribbon, they could not have made a prettier present to Allied military commanders. The messages were supplemented by others sent through the Japanese naval attaché machine, being read by Frank Raven and his team at the naval annex. As it happened, Japan's military attaché in Berlin was the polar opposite of Oshima. He hated and distrusted the Nazis and built his own spy network throughout France. So much the better for the Allies reading the dispatches. Raven and his crew called him Honest Abe, and what he learned about German coastal defenses also found its way to the D-Day planning operation. So did German Army Enigma messages read with the help of the bomber machines at the naval annex. At Bletchley in England, codebreakers broke a long message from German Field Marshal Erwin Rommel, describing defenses along the Normandy beaches. Together, the intelligence from these code-breaking efforts helped Allied commanders decide that they would concentrate their forces away from Calais and make their D-Day landing in Normandy.
That's really great. Yeah. I mean, that really paints a picture. You had mentioned that this book is in enormous detail, and it is. So thank you for sharing that. I think that gives our viewers a little bit of in detail how well studied this Liza Mundy, how much research. So now, can you tell us where Liza found all this information about this subject?
She went to the National Archives, and the National Archives just, what do you call it when you de-something?
Declassified them.
Declassified.
Okay, yeah.
They had just declassified these, I think, in and around 2000.
In 95. So I found that Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan released the records on July, some of the records, on July 11th of 95, 49 of them. And then again in September of 1995, more were released, but then the rest of them were like 2007.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So,
and
yeah.
She took boxes and boxes of records and letters and all kinds of information and studied them.
Could she just take them home and sign them out?
Well, I don't know if she took them home or not, but she...
She could sit and look
over
them.
Yeah, she could sit and look over them. And she spent several years doing that. And the interesting thing is, you know, when World War II was over, these girls were told, you know... As Anne Cara Christie put it, we were given our "here's your hat, what's your hurry" speech.
Yeah.
They asked them, that made them take an oath that they wouldn't divulge any information.
Right.
And then they said, now it's your duty to get off the government, out of the government as soon as you can.
Thanks, but get out.
Thanks, but, you know, thanks and here's your hat.
Yeah.
And they were told never were they to utter any word about what they did. So even as they got back to their normal lives after the war,
right.
They didn't let a whole lot,
they didn't share
a lot with their families, their husbands. Liza Mundy was fortunate enough to find at least 20 code girls that were still living that gave her interviews, and she made videos with them. And even this Dot Braden Bruce, who is living in a
do we have her picture
facility
somewhere?
her son and even her brother had asked her what she did in the war, and when she said she had a very important job of breaking codes, her brother said, she just had a desk job. She's just trying to make it sound like a big deal.
Right. Yeah.
But then...
Now, what's this picture of here? Is this her and her
that's
family?
That's Dot Braden Bruce, yes.
Yeah.
In
her
the
96th
center.
Or 97th birthday.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And as of this week, she's still living.
Yes.
She is now 99. And
wow.
She still practices her French with some of the other people there that
yeah.
speak French. And she enjoys the notoriety she's had since
yeah.
Liza put her book out. And she's, you know, just...
Living life to the fullest.
Yeah.
So we got to cheer her on to make it to 100, right? Now at
she
this point.
She said she wanted to live to be 101. That's what she said.
Okay. Well, good for her.
Her son,
yeah.
even when Liza Mundy came to talk with her, when he sat there for the interview, even he hadn't heard
his mouth
some
fell
of
open,
things.
He couldn't believe it.
Yeah,
so.
He couldn't believe what he was hearing.
So apparently we have another guest caller that's called in. Thanks for joining us. Who's this?
Hi, this is Larry again.
Yes, Larry. What can we help you with now?
Well, I'm enjoying your program.
Yes.
But I just want to kind of give some input as to the post-war and even during war secrecy of the cryptologists.
Yes, please share.
they were sworn to that, whether they were male or female.
Okay.
And to this day, mm-hmm. anyone in the cryptology aspects of our military, and a good friend of my son, my one son, went to the Naval Cryptology School down in Pensacola.
Oh, nice.
He will not talk about it. They're not permitted to talk about it. And people who serve on nuclear vessels, specifically nuclear submarines, mm-hmm. are sworn to secrecy throughout their life.
Yeah.
If you talk with anyone who has served on a nuclear submarine, and you ask them about what they did, what they saw, their response should be, I can't talk about it, it's classified. If they begin telling you facts, they are either lying or they're treasonous. So the going back to World War II, when these women were doing their work, most of our cryptology work for the Allies was being done in England, outside London, in an area called Bletchley Park.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the secrets of World War II are still being kept secret. So
yeah. mm-hmm.
it wasn't like discrimination against these code girls.
Yeah.
They provided a valuable service, but it wasn't like they were being discriminated against.
Yeah. I did find that the Senator Patrick Moynihan had released these and declassified them, but I couldn't figure out why. And I did some research. One of his children had already passed away. I couldn't locate the other one, and his daughter is an actress, a minor actress of sorts. So it didn't say anything about a spouse. But I was trying to understand why he chose to declassify these in particular, Larry, and our other guests. You know, cryptology was such a secret and still is a very secret thing.
Well, sometimes people who know stuff, politicians, they can hardly wait to blab. We go back to President Carter to prove that he was very pro defense and military. Gave away and let it out that we had created a stealth airplane.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Prior to him saying that, it was still secret. But once he kind of wanted to prove, no, I'm not soft on defense, the secret was out.
Yeah.
It's the stealth fighter, mm-hmm. the
F-117. So he wanted to have the bragging rights to say
he wanted to show his critics that I'm not soft on defense or anything. I'm just as tough as everybody else.
And here's the proof of it.
And politicians are known for doing that,
mm-hmm.
unfortunately.
Interesting.
Yeah. But anyhow, it's a great show, gals.
Thanks for joining us. And
welcome. Bye-bye.
Thanks. And if anybody else wants to join in on the conversation with Larry and us ladies this evening, our number here is 610-378-0426. And Larry, thanks for calling. That's really helped our conversation, I think, be a little more lively and a little bit more of a history lesson that we didn't have before.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you so much. So we talked about Daniel Moynihan, and I believe I read that there were some items that were actually in the Smithsonian. Do you know what may have been put in the Smithsonian? I think I found that out and you did not.
I don't know.
Yeah, it didn't really mention what items were there, but if you're ever down in the area, check out the mm-hmm. Smithsonian, and then on another call, you can call and tell us what you found, right?
Yeah.
So, okay. So the last few minutes of our show, I wanted to move on to our other guest primarily and talk more about the Historical Center and where it is and when it's open and what events you do, because you guys have had some things going on yourselves.
Well, my main purpose to coming on the show tonight was to talk about the women's suffrage movement that mm-hmm. was popular more than 100 years ago. But Hallie is one of my very best docents at the Berks History Center. She's been volunteering for me and doing guided tours for about 15 years. Mm-hmm. And the story goes that about 6 months ago, Hallie realized that the 100th anniversary of the 19th Amendment was just around the corner, and she didn't want that momentous occasion to pass without some sort of a celebration. So she gathered her friends from an organization that was, it's known as the Berks County Commission for Women. It celebrated its 20th anniversary, however, about 3 or 4 years ago, due to lack of participation and active members, they decided to disband. And what they did was donate all of their research and materials to the Berks History Center, which is in our Henry Janssen Library now. And then they gave their remaining balance to put in a restricted fund. And for the last few years, it has funded a women's history program during the month of March. Mm-hmm. So the core group of the commission, which kind of adopted me many, many years ago, got together for lunch, and we discussed how we were going to celebrate. So what's come about is we formed what we're calling the Women's History Alliance, and we've had two meetings so far. We've gathered about 25-plus women's groups here in Berks County, and so we have a web page now. And if we could pull that graphic up, it would be great, but it's the Women's Suffrage 2020 Centennial.org. So the purpose to this webpage is for you to go on there and get information, but also it's a place where we can create a schedule of events. And so the Berks History Center is hosting the kickoff event. Hallie Vaughn will be portraying Alice Paul. And that'll be the second Saturday. It's being held. We have regular second Saturday programs. So next March, second Saturday program, Hallie will talk about the suffrage movement and the 100th anniversary of the passing of the amendment. And then we're going to fill in a whole bunch of other activities and then end it on August the 26th, which is National Equality Day. Mm-hmm. And that will be with a dinner at the Doubletree, a celebration. Hallie would like to march on Penn Street. We may not do that. We might just walk on the sidewalks, but she would love to have a parade and a big celebration, but those are hard to organize. So we'll walk at least several blocks and then end up at the Doubletree. But do you have anything to add about this, Hallie?
Not really. I know we've been trying to get in contact with women's groups in Berks County, all different groups. Mm-hmm. So if you're watching this evening and you're in a group and we haven't contacted you yet, you can use that Berks Suffrage 2020 Centennial website and go on there and look at it and find out. I think our next meeting is May the 1st.
May the 1st.
At 5 o'clock at the History Center. Mm-hmm. And we'll be talking and sharing ideas. Vicki and I and the rest of the Alliance, we're not planning things. We're just hoping that those of you who have groups that would like to do a certain project will put it on our interactive calendar and get other people interested in helping with that or going to that event. Just sharing ideas and not letting the year go by without really celebrating the 19th Amendment that gave women the right to vote.
And of course, the journey towards the amendment began in the 1840s, is that correct?
1848.
And that was with the a convention in New York?
Yep. And Seneca Falls.
And who were the two women that were involved at that point?
Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony.
It just took a second. Yeah. No, I think you're correct.
I actually, when I was in Boston a few years ago, we found her grave when we went on a tour. And I love seeing every year on Election Day all the I voted stickers all over her tombstone. It's just kind of like, I would drive, if I could, drive 8 hours just to stick my little sticker on there just once. So, but it's quite a sight to see. And see such an amazing tombstone, knowing the life that she lived and all that she's given us, the rights, and future generations of women for what they did. So,
well, again, the next meeting of the Women's History Alliance is on May the 1st at the Berks History Center, and everybody is welcome. If you're not part of a women's group, that does, you can come on your own. You don't have to represent a group. There are committees that are have been formed and are being formed. We need volunteers. We need ideas. We need people who are willing to help put things together. And it'll be a really great, like, six-month celebration during 2020.
So what other groups have already joined you?
Well, the League of Women Voters.
Yay! Okay.
The Junior League of Reading.
We've had a representation from all of the colleges. We've had a lot of, like, female study professors from Alvernia and Albright come to the meetings. The Girl Scouts, has been
important.
Very prominent. AAUW has sent quite a few.
Some of the women's clubs in Berks County.
The women's clubs. I'm trying to think. There was, I think they're called the Charity Chicks. I was just talking to this woman after your program a couple of weeks at the Berks History Center, and I thought that a very clever name, the Charity Chicks.
Yeah.
And they get together and have lunch once a month and take up a collection and then donate it to a worthy cause. And she's like, well, I don't really know if I'm a right fit for this. And I said, of course you are. Anybody is a right fit
anybody.
For this.
Yeah. Yes.
And of course we would love to have men. We've only had one male attended our program, so we'd like to have a few more come to our meetings. And you know, we plan to meet about every other month and just celebrate what this really means for all of us.
Okay.
Yeah.
What kind of committees are being formed or have been formed where you're looking for volunteers?
We have an education committee putting together a list of speakers so that if your organization or if we forgot to mention the Berks County Library System is participating, and in particular the Reading Public Library, but just a list of people who could come out and talk about related issues. We also have, for the big dinner on August the 26th, there's a committee for that, and we're looking for someone. We'd really like to have a big name speaker come, and there's also publicity, fundraising. You know, we're hoping to, we need some kind of seed money for this celebration, so there's lots of different opportunities for your talents if you're interested in helping.
Yeah.
Or donations would be welcome, I'm sure.
Yes.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
So tell me where you guys are located and what hours you have at the center there.
We're open Tuesday through Saturday. Tuesday through Friday, we're open from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Saturdays, we're open from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Summer is around the corner. Once we celebrate Memorial Day, we will only be open until 2 p.m. on a Saturday. Okay. We close an hour earlier in the summertime. And again, we're located at 940 Center Avenue. If you're concerned about parking, plenty of street parking, because we are in the Center Park Historic District. Many of the homes surrounding us are bigger homes with garages, so street parking is plenty, but you can also park behind our building in our lot at the Berks History Center.
And are you guys on social media?
Oh, definitely.
Okay, so share that with us, please.
Well, I am not the social media person.
Okay.
So you've put me on the spot. But our wonderful Director of Communications and Associate Director, Alexis Campbell, we have a Facebook page. She does Twitter. So, you know, if you go to our webpage, all those connections are there for you.
The little icons to click on.
Yes, I am one of the few people my age that does not have a Facebook page.
Okay. Well, we need to get you into the future. No.
Okay.
But yes, that's exactly how I found you. So that worked out
great.
Very well. So, well, I will say thank you so very much to my guests this evening and for our caller that we had in to share some of that history and make our conversation, I think, well, more rounded and
we learned
and
about
a little
the
more
Marines.
Lively.
And I did think the Marines were around
I know,
that long.
I did.
Yeah, yeah. So a little out beyond my time. But so we from the League of Women Voters, thank you for joining us this evening. And as always, we will be back next month with another exciting conversation. And thank you and have a good night. Thanks for joining us.